This video is sponsored by Blue Apron. The first 100 of my viewers to sign up will get $40 off their first 2 weeks. The link is in the description. Last week, I launched my new website that included a section where you could submit suggestions for future videos. I've already gotten hundreds of suggestions, and I promise I'm reading and considering all of them. In fact, this video exists as a result of one of those suggestions. It was this one. They said, "I tend to focus more on US companies and neglect the rest of the world." And I have to agree with that. I'm from the US, so I tend to focus more on those companies. It's honestly much harder for me to talk about something I'm not familiar with, but these are perfect circumstances to give it a try. Easter is days away, and there happens to be a UK company that's associated with Easter, Cadbury. In the UK, Cadbury is considered one of the biggest, most well-known candy makers. That is not the case in the US. When I hear the name Cadbury, the first thing I think of is the butler from Richie Rich, though that may be unique to me. The biggest thing I associate with them is the Cadbury cream egg. It comes around every Easter. But most Americans may not realize that there's so much more to this company. It goes all the way back to 1824 with a guy named John Cadbury. He opened a shop that sold tea and coffee, which sounds like a very British thing to do. And as a side offering at this shop, he offered cocoa and drinking chocolate. It wasn't long before that became the center of his business. He opened some factories and soon enough, he had a sizable chocolate company. Moving ahead to 1861, John Cadbury had some health issues and he left the company in the hands of his two sons. When they were put in charge, the business still wasn't all that big and was actually in a bit of a slump. They had to take a big gamble to try to save the company. There was this new machine on the market, some kind of press that would squeeze the cocoa butter out of the beans and help make the cocoa more pure. They called this product Cocoa Essence and advertised the purity of it. It was a great way to separate themselves from the competition, and according to the company themselves, the marketing of Cocoa Essence helped increase sales dramatically and transformed a small business into the worldwide company that Cadbury is today. So, good call in buying that machine. It's a great lesson in how taking a risk like that may be necessary to achieve big things. Had they played it safe, they probably wouldn't exist today. In 1905, they introduced Cadbury Dairy Milk. They emphasized the fact that it contained milk so heavily because that was much more uncommon back then. Before dairy milk, the milk chocolate industry was mostly dominated by Switzerland, so a UK manufacturer coming out with milk chocolate was big news. In 1919, Cadbury made a big move by purchasing a competing chocolate company named Fry's. I say it was a big move because not only was this one of the biggest chocolate makers in the UK, they also invented the chocolate bar. It was more than 50 years earlier, but buying the people who invented the chocolate bar? That's pretty cool. A couple years later, they came out with their famous handwritten logo that they still use today. Interestingly enough, it was based on the signature of William Cadbury, who's the grandson of John Cadbury, the guy who started the whole company nearly 100 years earlier. In 1969, Cadbury decided to merge with Schweppes. A bit of a strange agreement. The two companies didn't seem to benefit from each other all that much. Schweppes is the maker of the carbonated water, which doesn't really complement a candy maker. Everything from the two was made in separate factories and shipped separately to the same locations. It didn't help their efficiency, so it's believed that their motive behind the merger was to help Cadbury expand, I guess specifically into the US. The thinking being that the Schweppes company would now share that goal, and Cadbury could now use Schweppes' resources to help them expand. The merger lasted nearly 40 years before the two split apart in 2008, but Cadbury didn't remain single for long because they were bought by Kraft a couple years later. It was a big acquisition. The price came out to nearly $19 billion, partially because Cadbury had picked up a few acquisitions of their own over the years. They were the owner of Halls and Trident and Dentine, so with this acquisition, Kraft owned all of it. And then Kraft split into two parts. The company that owns Cadbury today is called Mondelez. So technically, I may not be following up on this suggestion, because after almost 200 years as a British company, Cadbury today is technically owned by an American company. And many citizens of Britain were not happy about this. They like their chocolate company and take pride in it being from their country. But despite the current ownership, I think most people still consider Cadbury a British company. I certainly do. The big question I'm wondering is if Cadbury chocolates will ever be popular in America. They're owned by an American company now, so it seems logical that they would start popping up in more places. But it's more complicated than that. Hershey's has the rights to produce Cadbury chocolate in the US, so whatever is available is made by them, and not the people who make it in England. And when they make it differently. America and England appear to have very different tastes when it comes to chocolate. I learned that when I made my video about Hershey's and had a bunch of people from England commenting how bad it tastes to them. And I imagine it goes the other way as well, and that's why Hershey's chooses to alter the British chocolate for the American market. Let me ask the audience about it. If you've tried chocolate from both countries, how different did it taste? And which one did you prefer? I'm guessing the answer to that second question is whichever country you're from. So it's looking like if Cadbury really wants to break out into the United States, they're going to have to alter the recipe, but that's the recipe that they've perfected over the past couple hundred years for the British consumer. I would say because of this difference in taste, it would be much harder for them to expand into the US than you may initially think. But today in England, Cadbury has so many products. There's Boost, Bourneville, Chomp, Crunchy. Oh, I like the name of this one. Curly Whirly. There's also Double Decker, Flake. I don't really know any of these. I'm sure some of these are really big in the UK. If you're from the UK, let me know in the comments which of these are the popular ones, and also tell me which ones are the tastiest. Here's my guess. Dairy Milk is big, because it's one of the few that I've actually heard of, and plus it has 18 different varieties. I would also guess Flake and Roses to be big, and of course, the Cadbury Cream Egg. And since this is my Easter episode, let's go a little further into the Cadbury eggs. The first Cadbury egg dates back 143 years. It was dark chocolate and much different than the eggs we know today. 95 years ago is when they first filled it with cream, but they were still different from the eggs we know today. It wasn't until 47 years ago when they finally released the egg that we know today. This egg is made by taking two separate halves of chocolate and filling them with white fondant, then filling one of those halves with some yellow fondant as well. It all results in a sweet and gooey candy that weirdly resembles an egg. I've been seeing this exact same commercial every Easter for as long as I can remember. The pig and the lion and the turtle all put on their fake bunny ears and audition to be the Cadbury Bunny because everybody wants to be the Cadbury Bunny. He brings the Cadbury eggs. There's also a series of commercials that ran in the UK about 10 years ago that seem a little odd to me. In each one, the Cadbury egg would find a creative way to intentionally, I guess, kill himself, if that's possible for a cream-filled egg. They're oddly entertaining too. This one's my favorite. He sets up these books to fall like dominoes and then knocks over one side and runs over to the other side and dives under the final book just to get squished.
Go! Go! Go!
There were a lot of these. He stands in front of a blow dryer and melts, runs into a string tied to two nails and takes his head off, I guess. Each commercial ends with the line, "Here today, goo tomorrow." I think to represent how they're available up until Easter, then they can't be found. But instead of gone, it's goo. I can't even tell. Are these in poor taste? I know it's just a chocolate egg, but he's so adorable. And then repeatedly getting squished like that? Something just seems off about this. What do you think? Let me know in the comments, what do you think about that campaign? And what do you think about everything else? Are we going to be seeing more Cadbury products in the US anytime soon? Even if it never happens, I'm sure they're perfectly happy being one of the market leaders in England. They have such deep roots there, going back to 1824 and being present for or even popularizing so many innovations in chocolate. They bought the company that invented the chocolate bar. That's still pretty cool. And let me know how I did covering a non-American company. I know I came at it from an American perspective and relied on the help of the audience a couple times, but overall, did I do the company justice? I'd like to hear what you have to say. And speaking of delicious food, let me tell you about Blue Apron. With Blue Apron, you go to their website, choose which dishes you want from their menu, and they deliver all the farm-fresh ingredients you need to make them straight to your door. They're in the exact right proportions, no need to go to the grocery store, and no waste from unused ingredients. It even comes with an easy-to-follow recipe. I had the privilege of trying them out this weekend. Here's what I made. And I assure you, it tasted just as good as it looks. They have a large selection of recipes, they're always adding new dishes to their menu every week. They offer two-person and family meals, and their prices start as low as $9.99 per serving. I recommend giving them a try, especially since the first 100 people to sign up will get $40 off your first 2 weeks of Blue Apron. The link is in the description, and thank you for watching.